lives this morning.
It's good to see each one gathered with us, and we trust that the Lord will come near and minister to all of our hearts today. I'm going to read some words in the book of 1 John. 1 John and the chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 16. We have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. As we come to the house of worship today, we can say that we worship him because he loved us first. We love him. We seek to come in worship and adoration today because he intervened to love sinful rebels. We'll seek the Lord's face together in prayer. Our gracious Father, we thank thee for the love of God to the unlovable. We thank thee for the love of God to the unworthy. And today, we have not come then to proclaim our worthiness. We have come to confess our unworthiness, but to rejoice in the worthiness of our Lord Jesus Christ. O Lord, grant us help, we pray, in our time of worship here today. O Lord, we ask that our hearts will be truly focused on our Lord Jesus Christ and the wonders of the gospel of saving grace. So come and undertake, we pray, in our Lord's great name. Amen. We're going to turn in our hymn books, please. In our hymn books, and we're turning to the Psalm 27, and it's the second version of the Psalm at the front of the hymn book. The words that we're singing are on page 24. So page 24, and in the left-hand column, about halfway down, there are the words second version, Jehovah is my light and my salvation he, who then shall me affright. The Lord is unto me my life's sure stronghold. So it's the Psalm 27, the second version. It's on page 24, halfway down the left-hand side. We'll stand as we sing this.
Sure.
for the Lord again in prayer, please. Let's seek our Lord's face together in prayer. We need the Lord's help today. And just ask the Lord to be pleased to come and to minister to us. Our gracious Father, we thank Thee, O Lord, for the privilege that we do have to approach unto Thee today in prayer. We thank Thee for the one who is our light and our saving health. We thank Thee today that though we were born in darkness and lived in darkness, that the people of God have had that wonderful experience where the light has shone into their darkened hearts. We thank Thee for that day when the Lord said, "Let there be light." The light of the glorious gospel shone in to our darkened hearts. Though once we were in the midst of confusion, we thank Thee that our eyes have been opened to the truth. Today then we say, the Lord is my light. O Lord, we rejoice in the wonder of God's salvation. We rejoice in God's mercies, that You are pleased to open our eyes to our need and direct us to the sufficiency that there is in the person and work of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank Thee that that gospel that opened our eyes is the same gospel that is able to minister to men and women here and all around us who are yet without Jesus Christ. And O Lord, we pray today that Thou will be pleased to have mercy upon us and upon those in our neighborhoods and throughout this city and state that are still blinded in all of their need. And O Lord, we pray that today, that even in this place and around us, that we will see the light of the gospel shine into darkened hearts. And O Lord, we pray that there will be those that are brought to have this great testimony: the Lord is my light and saving health. O Lord, we recognize that we live in a day of terror, and a day when so many are in the grip of fear. Again, we thank Thee then for the testimony of the psalmist, that since the Lord is our light, we do not need to be afraid. O Lord, we pray today that our hearts will rejoice in Christ, that our hearts will rejoice in God's salvation. Lord, while we do not know what lies ahead, we thank Thee that our future, the future of our land, is in the Lord's hand, and whether that future would be dark or bright, we thank Thee that the Lord is always with His people, and even in times of trouble, that the Lord's people then can be very conscious that the Lord is with them, undertaking for them. O Lord, be pleased then today to come and to minister to us in this season of worship. We pray, O Lord, that every heart will be ministered to. We pray that not one will go away without hearing the Lord's voice. So then we pray that there will be words from heaven to every waiting soul. O Lord, we look to Thee, that Thou will be pleased to put Thy hand upon the sick. We pray for those that are going through times of pain and trial. O Lord, we pray that You'll minister to them. We pray that they will know that sufficiency of the Lord's grace, even for ongoing health troubles, and we pray that in thy mercy that they'll even be a raising up to better health and strength. And O Lord, we do cry to thee for those that are passing through times of trouble and turmoil, times of feeling the consequences of sin. We pray, O Lord, that as thy people, that we will be built up in our faith, and that in all of our various troubles, that we will be helped to see that the answer is in the Word of God, and help us then not to be hearers only, but to be doers of the living Word of God. So be pleased to come and minister to our hearts today. Bless our sister congregations. We pray, Lord, for the work of God in Port Lincoln and Lock, that you'll bless there today, for the work of God in Kingston in Tasmania, and bless the word that's preached there today. And yeah, Lord, we pray not only for our own denomination, but every faithful witness throughout our land. We thank thee for every place where the word of God is faithfully proclaimed. Pray, O Lord, that thou wilt be pleased to visit and pour out the Spirit of God upon us mightily. So, Lord, minister to us today, we pray. In our Lord's great name we ask. Amen. We're going to further worship the Lord, please, in singing. We're singing the hymn 592. 592. And well-known words, there is a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, and the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. 592, and we'll stand again as we sing these words. Genesis chapter 49.
These
are the 12 tribes of Israel. And this is it, that their father spake unto them, and blessed them, every one according to his blessing. He blessed them. And he charged them, and said unto them, I am to be gathered unto my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephron the Hittite. In the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre, in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with the field of Ephron the Hittite for a possession of a burying place. There they buried Abraham and Sarah his wife. There they buried Isaac and Rebekah his wife. And there I buried Leah. The purchase of the field and of the cave that is therein was from the children of Heth. When Jacob had made an end of commanding his sons, he gathered up his feet into the bed, and yielded up the ghost, and was gathered unto his people. And Joseph fell upon his father's face, and wept upon him, and kissed him. Joseph commanded his servants, the physicians, to embalm his father, and the physicians embalmed Israel. 40 days were fulfilled for him, for so are fulfilled the days of those which are embalmed. And the Egyptians mourned for him 70 days. When the days of his mourning were past, Joseph spake unto the house of Pharaoh, saying, If now I have found grace in your eyes, speak, I pray you, in the ears of Pharaoh, saying, My father made me swear, saying, Lo, I die. In my grave which I dig for me in the land of Canaan, there shalt thou bury me. Now therefore let me go up, I pray thee, and bury my father, and I will come again. And Pharaoh said, Go up and bury thy father, according as he made thee swear. And Joseph went up to bury his father. With him went up all the servants of Pharaoh, and the elders of his house, and all the elders of the land of Egypt, and all the house of Joseph and his brethren, and his father's house, only their little ones, and their flocks, and their herds, they left in the land of Goshen. There went up with him both chariots and horsemen. It was a very great company. And they came to the threshing floor of Atad, which is beyond Jordan. And there they mourned with a very great and very sore lamentation. And he made a mourning for his father 7 days. When the inhabitants of the land, the Canaanites, saw the mourning in the floor of Atad, they said, This is a grievous mourning to the Egyptians. Wherefore the name of it was called Abel Mizraim, which is beyond Jordan. And his sons did unto him according as he commanded them. For his sons carried him into the land of Canaan, and buried him in the cave of the field of Machpelah, which Abraham bought with the field for a possession of a burying place of Ephron the Hittite before Mamre. And we'll end there, knowing the Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his precious truth. I want to again welcome everybody to the house of the Lord this morning. It's good to see each one gathered with us, and especially to those that are visiting. We give you a very special welcome in our Saviour's precious name, and we thank you for coming to join with us here today. After the ministry of God's Word, there will be a brief time of refreshments, and then following those refreshments, there will be the Sunday school at 11:30 through until midday. This afternoon at 5 will be our afternoon service, and God willing I'll be here this afternoon continuing our studies in the Hallel Psalms, looking this afternoon at Psalm 116. The prayer meetings will be as usual in the incoming week, the meetings on Friday as usual, and then on Saturday there will be a busy bee in the afternoon for all that are able to come and to help. So that will be on Saturday in the afternoon at 2. And if there are others that would like to help with some work around the property at other times during the week, if you could let me know. So if you're not able to come to the busy bee and would like to help at another time, then you're certainly welcome to come and to do that. There's quite a bit of work to do around the property. We appreciate all that are able to help with that. And then the service is next Lord's Day at the usual times, and God willing, I'll be here to minister next Lord's Day. Next Lord's Day, being the final Lord's Day of the month, it will be the church lunch. So the church lunch, it will be next Lord's Day after the morning meetings. I think these are all the announcements, and they are made subject to the Lord's precious will. We're going to turn in our hymn books again to the back of the hymn book, 594. And as we sing these words, the offering for the work of the Lord will be received. So 594, we'll remain seated at the beginning of the hymn. If you didn't come prepared for an offering, just let the bag pass by. 594, when my life work is ended. And we'll remain seated.
Thank you.
please, in God's Word, to Genesis chapter 49, after Jacob gave the blessings to each of his sons, we read in verse 29, he charged them and said unto them, I am to be gathered unto my people. I am to be gathered unto my people. Verse 33, when Jacob had made an end of commanding his sons, he gathered up his feet into the bed and yielded up the ghost and was gathered unto his people. We'll seek the Lord's face together, please, in prayer. Need the Lord's help as we come and consider his truth together. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, may we thank thee that for the child of God, that we need not fear death, that Christ came to deliver us from that fear that the devil holds men and women and young people in bondage. And we pray today that our hearts will be gladdened as we consider this great testimony of dying Jacob. And O Lord, we pray for any in our gathering that are not yet prepared for that day of their departure. O Lord, we pray that today that their hearts will be opened to the gospel. Today preparation will be made for God's great eternity. And so, Lord, come and grant help, we pray, and give that help and enablement of the Holy Spirit of God. Pray in our Lord's great name. Amen. Amen. Samuel Davies was a great evangelist and Presbyterian minister in North America in the 18th century. He followed Jonathan Edwards as the president of Princeton University. Edwards only held that position for a very short time. Before he died, and then Samuel Davies entered into that position in 1761, or towards the end of 1760. Samuel Davies was one of the first missionaries to the slaves in the colonies, and he sought to emphasize that we all come from one race, and all men are to be reached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it is he that is the writer of that famous hymn, Great God of Wonders, all thy ways. Who is a God like thee? Beginning of 1761, he preached a sermon on the subject of death. It was his New Year's sermon. And he based them in the text, Jeremiah 28:16, and in that text it says in it, this year thou shalt die. This year thou shalt die. And he said in that sermon, it's not only possible but highly probable that death may meet some of us within the compass of this year. A couple of weeks later, he preached on the subject of death again, reflecting on the death of King George. He said, death intrudes into royal palaces as well as into humble cottages. Death arrests the monarch as well as the sleep. He said, the alarm of mortality has sounded from the throne. He who lived for their benefit dies for their benefit too, dies to remind them that they also must die. And what he meant was that the king lived and labored for the good of the nation. And Davies argued he also died for the good of the nation, in the sense the king's death was a warning to the entire nation and the world, to remind them that we must all face death. We must all needs die. A couple of weeks after preaching those sermons, Samuel Davies himself died. He was only a young man in his 30s. Yet, as he had spoken a few weeks before, in this year it's probable that some of us will die. He had no idea that he was speaking of his own death. It reminds us we all must be prepared for death. It's interesting that of all the deaths we read of in the book of Genesis, and of course there are many, the most details that we are given about the death of anyone in the book of Jacob, about the death of anyone, are the details concerning the death of Jacob. And so a number of these deaths, it's only a very brief mention, but the death of Jacob, there is much said about it. There's much said about the arrangements, and much said then about these arrangements being fulfilled. And that's very fitting, because through his life, Jacob talked a lot about death, and especially his death. When he heard that news, or when he received that clothing of Joseph, and Jacob presumed that Joseph was dead, Jacob said, "I will go down into the grave unto my son mourning." Years later, when Jacob's sons came back from Egypt, and they were talking about this harsh governor, as they understood him to be, as they talked about this harsh governor, and how the harsh governor was saying that Benjamin must come to Egypt, he said, "You will bring down my grey hairs with sorrow to the grave." When Jacob was convinced later that Joseph was actually alive, he said, "Joseph, my son, is yet alive. I will go and see him before I die." And then when Jacob came to Egypt and saw Joseph, he said, "Now let me die, since I have seen thy face, because thou art yet alive." And he was really saying then, "I am now ready to die." Now all of that tells us that Jacob frequently thought about death. And it didn't mean that Jacob was of no earthly use. But rather we see that he had a very healthy outlook on life. He kept life in perspective as he kept death in perspective. And many people today don't want to give any thought to death, and thereby they're not really prepared to live right. But Jacob understood that if we are to live right, then we must be prepared to die. And while much is said about Jacob's death and funeral, it really does stand in contrast to his forefathers. For his own father, Isaac, there's only one verse taken to describe his death. Five verses to describe that of his grandfather, Abraham. But I want to draw your attention to this phrase, "gathered unto my people." Or as we have it at the end, verse 33, "gathered unto his people." Now we have already come across this particular clause in these studies in Genesis. So it was said of Abraham when he died, he was gathered unto his people. It was said of Isaac when he died, he was gathered unto his people. And I mentioned many, many months ago that that phrase, "gathered unto his people," is not just another way of saying he died. And when you examine all of these different references, it's clear it's not just another way of saying he died. Rather, what these verses teach us is that the person died. Then there was a gathering on to the people, speaking of the soul. And then following the gathering on to his people, there would be the burial relating to the body. So when you examine these passages, I'm not going to go back over all that ground again. It's very clear that the gathering onto the people relates to the soul. Now the difference between those details concerning Abraham and Isaac and this one is that Jacob had this testimony where he said to his sons, I am going to be gathered unto my people. So verse 29, he charged them and said unto them, I am to be gathered unto my people. And so it's not merely Moses bringing these words to us, he was gathered, though Moses does say that. But Moses tells us, Jacob had this testimony before he died. I am going to be gathered to my people. My soul is going to be reunited with my people. These are words of great assurance. These are words of great confidence. John Wesley once said, our people die well. And certainly, when we think here of Jacob, he was one that died well. He had this testimony, I am going to be with my people. And one preacher said, if this be dying, it is worthwhile living for the mere sake of dying. It is worthwhile living for the mere sake of dying. And what a blessed thing it would be to have a deathbed experience like this. And on your deathbed to testify, I'm about to be gathered unto my people. The title of the message then, the assurance of a great gathering. I want to see first of all the preparation for this gathering. The preparation for this gathering. For what people you will be gathered unto in eternity is dependent upon what people you have been gathered unto in life. And so Jacob could say, I am going to be gathered unto my people, because there was a people that he belonged to. And this people that he belonged to was not determined by blood. It was not determined by birth. But rather, it was determined by the new birth. I mentioned how Abraham and Isaac were gathered unto their people. But that same clause is used concerning Ishmael. When Ishmael died, Ishmael was gathered unto his people. Now Ishmael was not a converted man. The New Testament speaks of him as being fleshly. He was earthly. He had never been brought into grace. He was not a believer. He might have had the blood of Abraham, but he did not have the faith of Abraham. And so he might, and he was able to say, I was born into that family. But Ishmael did not have this testimony as Jacob did. I will go to be with Abraham. Ishmael was gathered onto another people altogether. He was gathered onto the unbelieving. Therefore, if you're to be gathered in the company of the saints in glory, you must belong to that company while you're still here on earth. Now, I'm not talking about merely having your name in a church register. Someone once quipped that if you're going to make your confidence of heaven based on having your name on a church roll, you might as well have your confidence in having your name written on a sausage roll. You're not going to get to heaven by having your name written in a book on earth. Rather, your name must be written in heaven. And you must be on earth brought to that assurance that your name is written in heaven. Not because of what you have done, but rather your confidence in Jesus Christ and His great salvation. And therefore, this company that I'm talking about is not merely the outward company of a meeting of God's people like this, but rather you must belong to that company that the Lord has marked out. The Lord knows them that are His. Now it's good and it's vital to be in a place of public worship. We're not to forsake that company. And yet this belonging goes beyond local church membership. We must be found in Jesus Christ. And so when Jacob then says, I go to be gathered unto my people, there's this sense of belonging. I belong with them. I go to be in their company, because I am already a member of the body that they are. And Scripture speaks then of this one great body, the Church of Jesus Christ. That body today is made up of those that are in heaven. We refer to them as the Church Triumphant. And it's made up of those that are God's people on earth, the Church Militant. But it's not two different bodies, it's one body. And therefore, to be in that company above, you must belong to the Church Militant while on earth. You must be in Jesus Christ. And we could put it another way. If it were possible, and it's not, for the unconverted to have just a moment in heaven, they wouldn't be able to stand it. If you've not been regenerated, if you've never been born again, you would never cope with heaven for a moment. You would desire to get from it. Romans 8 verse 7 says, the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. And to be prepared for God's heaven then, you need a new heart. There needs to be this regeneration as Scripture speaks of. You need to be born again. Your present makeup is not ready for heaven, because your present makeup is one that is sinful and against the clear word of God. So the Lord said to Nicodemus, if you're to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. If you're to be ready to enter heaven, you need to be born again on earth. You need to be in Christ. But as we think of the testimony of Jacob, there is good news. For while Jacob was a sinner of sinners, he was a twister, he was a schemer, he had not earned the right to enter heaven by his works. He couldn't. He was like you and I, a sinner. But we read beautiful words in the book of Hosea, chapter 12, verse 4. God found Jacob in Bethel. God found Jacob in Bethel. And we all know that word found is the idea of having sought out. And not that God didn't know where he was, but it has the idea God pursued. Perhaps there's someone in this meeting today and you're not yet converted. Here is good news. God is pursuing sinners. Maybe today the Lord is pursuing your heart. The Lord has been bringing concern where before there has been no concern. The Lord has been troubling you concerning spiritual matters, maybe even concerning eternity. God is searching you out. Oh, today that you would lift your eyes and see Him. Call out, Lord, have mercy on my soul. Prepare me for God's great eternity. The company in this gathering, where we'll be in eternity, is determined by who we belong to in this life. But I want to see then, secondly, the reunion in this gathering. Because Jacob here, as he brings these words, I'm to be gathered unto my people, he is not speaking these words in terror. Rather, there's this sense of anticipation. Yeah, there's a sense of longing. I am glad that I am to be gathered unto my people. I am yearning for this reunion with my people. Jacob then was assured that he was going to meet with that great company of the redeemed. Glory. You remember that scene in the Gospels where the Sadducees had a dispute with the Lord Jesus? The Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection, and they completely distorted the teaching of the resurrection and what reunion in heaven is. And they talked then about an Old Testament law, levirate marriage, and they applied that particular law to the reunion in heaven. Now, under the Old Testament law, if a man was married and he died without seed, without children, without one to inherit, under that unique circumstance, the next single near relative was to marry his widow. And so in this scenario that the Sadducees laid out, they said that after this man died, his brother married the widow. But he died as well, without having raised any seed. And so the third brother married the widow. He also died, and the story went on. And in the end then, these brothers all having married but not left a seed, which one would be married to the lady in heaven? And the Lord said, you err. You are in error. You have not understood the scriptures. There will be a great reunion. If that company were all redeemed, there will be a reunion of them in heaven, but not a marital one. The Lord then said, God is not the God of the dead, He is God of the living. God is God of the living. And He said that following the great statement, what God had said to Moses at the burning bush, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. As we relate that back to this great scene here where Jacob is dying, and Jacob says, I go to my fathers. I go to Abraham and Isaac. I'm to be gathered unto my people. I go to the living. That's how the Lord Jesus explained this. I go to the living. I go to a company who are alive. I go to a company that have vitality. Heaven then is more than a mere existence. There is reunion. There is communion. Relationships, as our Lord made clear, there are different in heaven. There's not marriage as we know it today. And while in a sense that might bring us some disappointment, it ought not. When we're disappointed about that, it's only because we haven't understood that there's something greater. That the Lord has something far better for us in glory. But what a reunion there is in heaven. Remember before the fall, when there was no sin, the Lord said, it's not good for man to be alone. And in heaven then, we will not be alone. As Jacob said, I am to be gathered unto my fathers. He was sure. I will not be alone. I will be in great company. Richard Baxter said, I know that Christ is all in all. And that in the presence of God, that makes heaven to be heaven. And so Richard Baxter was saying, yes, we must treasure this thought that in heaven we are taken up with Christ. And that's one of the reasons why the unregenerate won't, couldn't understand heaven. Yet it much sweetens the thought of that place to me that there is such a multitude of my dear and precious friends in Christ. Remember on the Mount of Transfiguration, Elijah and Moses were there. And they were in that sweet communion with Christ, speaking with him. They maintained their identity. So then there is that wonderful reunion in heaven. Hebrews chapter 12 speaks of that cloud of witnesses. And just as the spectators in the stadium are encouraging the athletes, so we are to see, as it were, the company in heaven exhorting us to continue in the Christian race, that we might come at the end of our race and join with them. Keep running. Keep running towards that great reunion day. Therefore, in the New Testament, a number of times, it does speak of our future gathering. 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 1, it talks about our gathering together unto him. Our gathering together unto him. It's actually the same Greek construction as those words we're all familiar with in the book of Hebrews. Don't forsake the assembly together. And so as we assemble together, from week to week we reunite. We're in company again. And so taking that same Greek word, Paul says, we'll have a gathering together. We'll have this great reunion. Surely there's that same sense in 1 Thessalonians 4:17, we will be caught up together with them in the clouds. Caught up together. Reunion. Company. Now in contrast, hell will be a place of reunion, but in an entirely different sense. Sinner in his death cannot say in any sense of joy, I'm going out to hell to be reunited with my people. Rather, that ought to be the thought of great consternation. For in hell, there is no appreciation of in hell, there's no rejoicing that my fellow sinners are with me. It's the place of outer darkness. It's the place of hopelessness. There is no consolation in companionship in hell. Remember that rich man, he lifted up his eyes in hell. Remember in his torments he was concerned about his brother's company. And he wasn't saying, let them go on their sin to be with me here. No, he said, I long that they would not come to this place. There's no consolation in hell. There's no consolation in company there. Today then, dear sinner, flee from that wrath that is to come. Prepare to meet thy God. How foolish it is when men live today and they speak of how well if I go to hell, at least I'll have those with me. Yes, you'll have your company with you, but you'll never enjoy it. There'll be no enjoyment in it. Come to the Lord. The company in this gallery, the reunion, and I want to see finally the timing for this gathering. Jacob, in verse 33, it says that after he had commanded his sons, and the command here is specifically in relation to the funeral arrangements, he'd already given these to Joseph, but now he gives them to all the sons. Jacob made an end of commanding his sons. He gathered up his feet into the bed, yielded up the ghost, and was gathered unto his people. He did not die until he had brought those words of prophecy to his sons. He didn't die until he had spoken those words about the funeral arrangements. When he had done that, his work was done. He then gathered up his legs into the bed. In exhaustion, he put back his head and he died. Now, we do not know the day when we shall leave this scene of time. The Lord knows. The Lord has appointed the day. Job acknowledged that. Job 14:5. Seeing his days, seeing the days of man are determined, the number of his months are with thee. Thou hast appointed his bounds that he cannot pass. Sometimes we talk about premature death. We're always to remember that we speak only in human terms in that sense. For no one can pass the bounds. No one can go beyond the boundary. Whatever the circumstances, we will die in the Lord's time. But we will not die until our work here on earth is finished. And the fact that we are still here today, whether in health or in weakness, is evidence that our work on earth is not done. If you were in glory already, that would be showing that your work was done on earth. But you're still here. For a purpose. The Lord has something for you to do. Or the Lord has something to do through you. Therefore you're still here. And this whole scene is actually a reminder of God's sovereign purpose. Some people, understandably, have very specific arrangements about their burial place. I would like to be buried near my relatives. And there's certainly nothing wrong with that. But Jacob, as he gave this instruction, take my body back to Canaan and bury it in that graveyard in Machpelah. There was a very specific reason for that. Far beyond a personal preference. It had to do with the promises of God. And when Jacob was saying, take my body and bury it there in Machpelah and in Canaan, Jacob was acknowledging God's promises have not yet been fulfilled. The children of Israel have not yet possessed Canaan. In this chapter we read the first mention of the tribes as the tribes. Jacob died saying, yes, God has raised up the tribes, but the land is not yet conquered. But he could die with this assurance, though my work is done, the work of God goes on. Though my work is done, God will see to it that this other matter will come to its fruition in God's perfect time. And we are to live with this sense then, that we won't die until it's God's time. And in the time that's left then, we are to engage in the Lord's service. We're to live our lives with this great function. Let me live every day to the glory of God, living in light of eternity, living in light of my death. And the great thing about Jacob's gathering on to his people was not merely to be with Abraham and Isaac, but the great thing about Jacob's departure was this. He was going to go to be with the God who found him at Bethel. He was going to be with the one that was revealed to him at Bethel. Remember, at Bethel there was that ladder. The angels of God ascending and descending on it. And the New Testament teaches us that that ladder speaks of Jesus Christ. He is the mediator between God and man. And remember how Jacob was taught the lesson at Bethel. Heaven is opened through the work of Jesus Christ. Today, dear sinner, heaven is closed to you. There's a shut door, as it were. But that door is opened through the work of Jesus Christ. The one who is truly God, but became man, with the purpose that he would die in the sinner's place. Why was Jesus Christ born as a baby in Bethlehem? One of the great reasons was that he would die as a man. If that hadn't been the case, there was no hope for you. Christ came to die that you might live. Christ came to die that heaven's door might be opened. And may it be your testimony then today as you go from this place, and not merely looking forward to heaven because of other believers that are there, but most of all, I long to see my Savior. May the Lord take his word upon each one of our hearts. Amen. We'll sing some words of the hymn 598 in closing. 598. Great words of testimony of the Christian. Face to face with Christ my Saviour. Face to face, what will it be when with rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ, died for me. If this is not your testimony, may you even come to Christ today. We'll stand, just singing the verse 1, and then we'll remain standing for closing prayer. 598.
Jesus Christ, turn down for me.
take thy word, write it upon every heart, whether you're here in Christ or out of him. O Lord, seal your word to every heart, we pray. Bring the lost to thyself. Lord, we pray that the eyes of thy people will be fixed afresh upon not merely the day of our death, but to that day when we shall see Christ in all of his beauty. We thank thee for the refreshments. Bless them to us. Bless our fellowship together. Bless the Sunday school time. Lord, may your blessing continually abide with us through this day. We ought to him that is able to keep you from falling, to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever.